4, 3, 2, 1.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Ladies and gentlemen.
The biggest names in music.
Oh, wow.
Big names. Big songs. Big guests. Big prizes.
Well, it's a big show.
Okay. The Big Show.
Put your hands together for the one and only.
Glenn, Angel, FD, and Sean.
That's what I'm talking about.
1FM 91.3.
Good times, greatest hits. 1, 2, 3.
Good morning, Singapore. Welcome to the big show. And today's special guest is top criminal defense lawyer. Top criminal defense lawyer. Mm-hmm. All right. We've seen him in papers, in the newspapers. We've read about some of his cases, and we are so privileged to have him on the show this morning. From Withers, Kata Wong, the one, the only, Shashi Nathan.
Good morning.
Morning, guys. Good morning.
Morning, Shashi. We go way back.
How way?
We used to play Sabutio table soccer in the late 70s.
Oh, wow.
At MPH Stamford Road. Remember that?
That's
Shashi?
Right. Yeah.
And Shashi back then wore, I think, big glasses. His lenses
were big glasses.
So what happened to the glasses, Shashi? Did you go for LASIK? Are you wearing contact lenses now?
I'm using contact lenses. I want to go for LASIK, but I'm scared. But I will do it one day.
You're scared.
We're very similar in that sense. I also want to go, but I'm a bit scared as well.
Maybe both of you can go together.
Yeah, maybe.
How about that?
We do one eye at a time.
You know what? My mom always tells me, please, Glenn, you look better with glasses. Don't do anything to your eyes. You know, this is a very sensitive operation.
I want to go by a couple of minutes. What is this football y'all used to play?
Table soccer. Sabutio.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've never heard of that.
And so, we used to be members of the Sabutio Association of Singapore.
Oh my goodness.
That's
and
right.
We used to take part in national competitions. There used to be two competitions a year during the school holidays, right? One was the Sabutio National Championship, and the other was the... there was another one, right, Shashi? Two.
There was the World Cup.
Ah,
where some of us would qualify and go and play in the World Cup.
Oh, I'm looking at it now. Now I know what it is.
So,
okay.
Shashi, what was Glenn like back in those days as a Sabutio player?
He got flip table on.
Was he a bully?
No, he wasn't. Actually, Glenn hasn't changed very much in all the years I've known him. I mean, one of my memories, Glenn, is you and your younger brother, Gary, coming to my home in Holland Drive. And, you know, we'll set up the table, we'll play, and a few others will come, and we'll have our leagues, you know. He goes up and down the league. We've both gone older, but, you know, he's very much the same person.
And he's still
football
crazy.
What you see
crazy.
Is what you get.
I'm actually, you know, tell the truth, Shashi, you know, as much as he is now a big-time top defense lawyer and all that, he's the same guy. He's a wonderful guy.
Without the thick glasses.
But I have to say, I mean, in terms of Sabutio, all right, because we're going to talk about this, like, you know, now and then, you know, we're not going to talk about it anymore. Both Shashi and myself, right, we were, I mean, of course, we were aspiring champions. We wanted to do really well. But I think we were average players, Shashi. We were average, right? I mean, there were players who were, like, really good,
But there were guys who were much better than us, but I think we all had our individual skills. I remember one of my favorite shots would like kind of dink the ball over the little figures and to get into the goal.
You said aspiring champions.
Or table soccer.
Okay, we weren't the worst.
We weren't the worst.
We were decent. Those days, you know, we didn't have computers and iPads. And this is our thing, you know. And I was just sharing with my colleagues earlier. You know, nowadays, you know, kids don't go and play in the longkang for guppies. They don't play football. They don't get scrapes. I mean, not that we were very energetic, but, you know, table soccer is a very strenuous sport.
It's
sport.
With your fingers. It's a sport. Yeah, it's a sport. It is a sport, kind of.
Yeah, your fingers, especially when the balls go down the cargo lift and we got to go downstairs and kind of look for the ball at MPH Stamford Road, Okay, anyway, we have with us our top criminal defense lawyer, Shashi Nathan, with us this morning. We'll continue this conversation live on thebigshow.tv. Meantime, here's Huey Lewis and the news. Stuck with you on The Big Show, 1FM 91.3.
All right, we're back.
We are back.
I had to Google this Sabutio soccer. Anyway, Shashi, we are now live on Facebook, and here come all the difficult questions.
Wait, before you ask, I just want to say good morning to a beautiful lady named Geraldine Nathan, who's tuned
in. Good morning, Jerry.
Good morning.
I hope you're tuned in. Good morning,
she's
Jerry.
Gone back to bed.
Long time no see. Love you.
I'm not sure whether she's tuned in. As I told you, when I left the house this morning, all she said to me is, don't say anything stupid.
But this is going to be on the internet forever. So
forever.
Can, that's right. You can watch this.
She can always watch it back.
In the afternoon.
You can remind me.
She will stop and play. See, this is what you said just now. Yeah. Evidence.
Just saying don't say something stupid was stupid enough. Okay, Mark.
Shashi, let's get down to you as a person. So, I mean, we know Glenn, and you've done the whole Sabutio thing as youngsters. Why law? And why criminal law? Because that's got to be one of the most difficult practices to get into.
Yeah. To be very honest, when I was younger, I mean, I didn't think I was going to be a lawyer. That wasn't part of my plan. Everybody else thought I should be a lawyer, but mainly because the teacher said I was too talkative. My parents said, oh, you better do law. You keep arguing with us. But that wasn't really operating in my mind so much. Obviously, as I got older, then I studied law. And when I first came back to Singapore after my studies, I wanted to do corporate law. I thought that was my thing, you know. But I remember coming for the interview, and within 5 minutes, the managing partner of the firm said, nope, sorry, you'll never make it as a corporate lawyer. You're not meticulous enough. You don't dot the I's and cross the T's. Mm. Sorry. So they threw me into litigation. And for 6 months, I did shipping. Shipping law as a pupil, yeah. Mm. And then I was very lucky because one of the senior partners in the firm got elevated to the bench to become a high court judge. And he had about 15, 20 files that he had left. And those files were given to me. To run. I was lucky, and within like a few months, I got one or two big cases. Mm. And, you know, the thing about criminal law is you're only as good as your reputation to some extent. You know, if you do decently in a few cases, then people remember you or other lawyers refer work to you. So I have to say my career has been peppered with a bit of luck. You know, you need to be at the right time, right place. And eventually, of course, once I got into it, I mean, I find the work fascinating. Mm. Even today, I've been practiced for 27, 28 years. I wake up every day with a huge excitement because you're meeting new clients, new facts, new cases. I've never got bored of it. You know, it's just so fascinating, every aspect of this area of practice that I do.
Wow.
Wow, that's fabulous. So if you weren't a lawyer, Shashi, what would you be doing?
Well, thankfully not a Sabutio player. I don't know, you know.
What did you want to be when you grew up? You know, when you were younger? What did you aspire to be?
Footballer.
Yeah, but I was never going to be good enough for that. And the thick glasses would have got in the way. I don't know. When I was growing up, you know, you had different things. I think at one time I wanted to be a vet for some reason, but that quickly died. When I was 16, I wanted to become a Catholic priest.
Oh, wow. Okay. That's the same as our Sean.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, he growing was going to be, yeah.
Not a priest.
Growing up, I remember... after O-levels, I spoke to my father and I said, look, I think I'm going to join a seminary. I want to be a Catholic priest. I moved away before he could slap me. And then he said, you go and finish your education first, you finish your degree, all then we come, then you decide. Right now, you know, you don't know what you're talking about, so... Yeah, but I lost that call very quickly.
But, you know, I think you would have made an amazing Catholic priest, actually.
Yeah.
Amazing
so.
Catholic priest.
Yeah, I think so.
You know, many people would have gone to jail because, I mean, you're not there to defend them. But I think Shashi is a blessing that, you know, I mean, he's...
He
defends...
True.
And later on, when we go on air, I'm going to be talking about the criminal law aid system.
Okay.
Legal aid system, rather, that Shashi is so, you know, passionate about. And that is, you know, for people who can't afford
the pro bono work.
We'll talk about that later when we go on air.
Okay.
Live.
Right. So should I ask him about his cases now or later?
Well, you can ask him a few cases. I mean, we can revisit that later. Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
so Shashi, your biggest cases or most memorable cases?
I don't know about biggest cases because, you know, I think every case resonates with people differently. Mm. And I've been lucky enough to be involved in some of the biggest cases in Singapore. But one case that I think stays with me a lot was a case I did in about 2006. And this was a case where the police found a dismembered lady. Her head was found in Orchard Road MRT station. Oh. Her limbs and her body was found in McRitchie Reservoir. Mm. And I was asked to defend another Filipino lady who killed her. Mm. And I think the interesting thing about that case is what the public reads or what the facts show sometimes don't always pan out in court. Mm-hmm. So, for example, I think... when everyone started reading about the facts of the case, it was very macabre, it was gruesome. You find a head in Orchard Road, you find the hands and the limbs all over the place. But as the investigations developed and we had negotiations with the prosecutors, we found that actually the two girls had had a fight. They were fighting over money. They were both actually attacking each other. And in the course of that fight, they were both trying to strangle each other. Mm. And of course, one girl won out and my client managed to strangle the other girl. Mm. The cutting of the body took place maybe 2 days later when the body was left and she panicked. After 2 days, the body goes to rigor mortis. Mm. It is actually dead weight. You can't lift that body. And my client was like 5 foot nothing. Mm. In a tiny girl, I think the other girl is a bit taller. She just couldn't carry the body. Mm. So in her own mind, the best way she could think of getting rid of the body was to cut it up.
Oh, wow.
Okay, hold on, Shashi. We'll talk about this again when we come back live on Facebook. We're going back on the radio right now. Stand by. Sarah Bareilles with Brave right here on The Big Show, 1FM 91.3. We have with us top criminal defense lawyer, Shashi Nathan from Withers, Qatar Wong. Once again, welcome to the show, Shashi. Now, we established just now on TheBigShow.tv that you would have started out as a corporate lawyer. Now, for the benefit, you wanted to, yes. For the benefit of those people who are not watching us on TheBigShow.tv, what made you choose to go into criminal law once again?
Like I said, it's a bit of providence and fortune. I wanted to be a corporate lawyer when I first qualified, but I kept getting told it wasn't my fit and I wasn't good enough. So one of the people I was in the firm that I was working for, one of the very senior partners, got elevated to the High Court bench. And he had left a few files before he went up, and I was assigned the files as a young junior lawyer to deal with it. And I guess I got a bit lucky because I liked the work. I had a few good early successes. And before I knew it, I was a criminal lawyer.
So you gracefully fell into criminal law.
Yeah, maybe gracefully it'd be. I fell into it, yeah.
Is it tougher to be a criminal defense lawyer as opposed to a corporate lawyer?
Well, I think every... practice has its own difficulties and stresses. I have friends who are corporate lawyers. They deal with stressful situations, with deadlines, with client demands. So I think it's different. Criminal law is unique in that you're dealing with people who are facing personal problems, problems that could hinder their life, their liberty. And you're not just dealing with the client. Many times we find that we're dealing with the rest of the family, the spouse, the children, the parents. They all come and get involved in the case. So, you know, you're not just a lawyer. You become a counselor. You become a social worker. You become a confidant to some of your clients. So those are some of the things that, of course, make it more difficult. And, of course, the nature of the work, you're dealing with sometimes difficult situations, and you have to deal still with the adversarial system in court, where you have to argue your cases against prosecutors. You have to convince judges on the issues of fact, on law. So it's a continual struggle, but it's also very rewarding, because as and when, and it doesn't happen that often, but when you do get good results, or you get something for your client, or you manage to convince the court of the appropriate result, then I think not only for your client but for the lawyer, I think it's extremely satisfying. You feel you've done something good.
We are with Shashi Nathan this morning right here on thebigshow.tv. It's John Cicada next, Just Another Day on The Big Show, 1FM 91.3.
Yeah, back, we are live.
Oh dear. Okay, Shashi.
Sorry, we dropped for a little while just now.
This is part two. We are part two. Everybody's
still watching. So, Shashi, we were talking earlier about this case that you had in 2006. So, just a recap of you defending a domestic worker, a Filipino domestic worker, who was charged or accused of strangling her friend over money. Killing her, and she was charged with it. Yes,
she was charged for murder originally.
Okay, okay. Tell us more.
This is a very interesting case, because I was actually appointed to act for her by the Philippine government.
Oh wow! Okay.
So the embassy got in touch with me in Singapore, and they've been fantastic. The Philippine embassy really looks after the Filipinas who live in Singapore, and they got in touch with me. They asked me to help her. And so my team and I, we got involved. We basically met her, tried to understand what really happened. Mm. And what we had to do, I think the most important thing we did, was to convince the court to look at it from a different angle. Because if you just heard about the case from the press, from the papers, it's a terrible crime, gruesome, you know, bodies cut up, parts all over Singapore. Yeah. Your natural aversion to the facts make you want to go against her. Mm. So what we had to do is to explain, not just to the court, but also to the prosecution, like, this was really two good friends who had a fight. It was unfortunate. In the course of the fight, one of them died.
Gone wrong.
To kill her. Mm. And of course, the cutting of the body was an aftermath. It was something that happened after. So to connect the two is not always fair. You know, and it was, we were very lucky. We had a very good judge, Justice V.K. Raja, who went on to be a Court of Appeal judge. He saw it from the off. He saw that the killing is very different from the cutting of the body, which was really more or less disposing of evidence rather than the actual. It's not as if the lady died because of the cutting.
Right.
And what happened was the prosecution, also very fair, they reduced the charge to one of manslaughter.
Okay.
So the judge could have given her a life sentence, but eventually ordered a sentence of 10 years.
Okay.
And after good behavior, she served 6 years, and she's gone back to the Philippines.
Okay, that's interesting. Okay. So, Shashi, in terms of lawyers and the industry, whether it's here in Singapore or anywhere around the world, who inspires you?
Actually, a lot of people do. You know, one of the things about the criminal bar is there is, and which is, I suppose it's prevalent in the other bars as well, but the criminal bar is particular, and there's a very strong sense of camaraderie. So, you know, before we go to court or in between hearings, I'm often seen in the court bar rooms where the lawyers congregate. And the thing is, the criminal bar, we're really all on the same side. It's us against the prosecution. It's us presenting our cases. So there's no real competitiveness amongst us. Mm. We help each other. You know, oh, you've got a case, I've got a case I could help you with. So I still remember one of my first cases. I think I was maybe 3 or 4 months into practice. And I came across a judge who was extremely difficult. I mean, he knew I was junior and he was bullying me a little. And I do remember when I came to court and we started the trial, his first words to me was, so Mr. Nathan, when, not if, when I convict your client, no? And he's looking at a long jail term. And I said, that's ridiculous. He's prejudged the case even before hearing any facts.
Right.
So I was really upset. You know, I was, and I said, my God, I've lost the case before I've even started it.
Mm.
And I went down to the bar room and I sat down, I think feeling a bit sorry for myself. And before I knew it, a whole group of very senior lawyers, people like Subhash, people like Palakrishnan, Leo Fernando, Mark Weng Seng, very senior criminal lawyers. These were all men in their 60s. I was in my 20s. They came around the table and said, young man, what's the problem? And so I told them, you know, this is one of my first trials. The judge is bullying me, you know, I don't know what to do. And they said, look, just go up, do your best for your client. And I said, okay. I went up, and this is a really small courtroom in the old days in the state courts. Before I knew it, as the trial started, all of them, there were 6 or 7 of them, they all came up, and these are the most senior criminal lawyers in Singapore at that time. They sat in the gallery to watch me.
Wow. That must have intimidated the judge as well.
The judge changed completely.
Wow.
You know, he says, why are all these lawyers here, you know? And they said, look, this is the public gallery. We're entitled to come and watch any trial. And the trial went on for 3 days, and my client got acquitted.
Oh, nice. Wow. Well done.
The gang was there.
These are legends, man. Like people like Palakrishnan and all that, they were legends.
I think that more than anything tells you so much about the camaraderie at the bar. And, you know, now that I'm one of the older gents at the bar, we want to do the same thing for the young lawyers as well. So we make sure every young criminal lawyer that enters the bar room, enters the courts, he or she is not alone. We have the whole criminal bar behind you. Mm. We'll support you. We'll help you. We'll teach you. We'll, you know, I won't forget what those lawyers did for me when I was a young lawyer. So I'll make sure that we do this back for the new lawyers coming into the practice.
Nice.
Awesome.
Nice.
Well done.
Speaking of new lawyers, you know, Shashi, I've always wanted to be a lawyer. Like, I've always wanted to follow my dad's footsteps. Is it too late for me?
No, it's not too late.
Not at all.
Okay, I've got Shashi. I've got so many, like, lawyer friends, and I can have them all as my mentors.
And they need more female criminal defense lawyers as well. Okay.
And think about this. Every time you go to court, you'll have Shashi and 12 other people
right?
in the courtroom.
Right, yeah.
Well, Angel, I still remember your father coming to court. I mean, coming to the bar room, and he wasn't a criminal lawyer that much. I think he did a bit of everything.
Yeah.
But I do remember him coming to court in the early days.
Yeah. And I'm sure he would have helped you out.
He did in many other ways. You know, sometimes for young lawyers starting practice, for older lawyer to just sit and, you know, spend some time asking him, making him feel comfortable, making him feel part of the fraternity.
Mm.
That does a lot more for a young lawyer than people realize.
For your self-esteem and everything, right?
Yeah.
So can I just ask, because hearing all your stories about the cases and stuff like that, very, very interesting. The only thing I know about law is what I see on Suits, the TV show. Have you watched Suits? The one with Meghan Markle?
I do.
How accurate is it?
Well, okay. I've got a wonderful secretary, but she's not the same as... although that's probably a good thing for me, because if my secretary looked like the secretary in Suits, I don't think I'd get any work.
And Jerry will have something to say about it.
Yeah,
he'll
have a lot of things to say.
Okay, that's why it's good. Okay, we're going back.
You see programs on TV about lawyers and all that. I mean, some of it.
Shashi, hold on. We're going for a traffic break. We'll come back on the radio. Okay, hold on.
1FM 91.3 traffic.
If you're out and about, there are a few places to look out for. The SLE towards the BKE, an accident at the BKE PIE exit. Also, the SLE towards the BKE, an accident at Woodlands Avenue 12 entrance. SLE towards the BKE, between Woodlands Avenue 12 and the BKE exit. Very, very heavy traffic there, so expect delays if you're in that area. Stay within the speed limit. Have everyone buckled up. Be safe as you drive today.
Good morning, Singapore. We are back on The Big Show and TheBigShow.tv. Our guest for this morning, top criminal defence lawyer from Withers Cutter Wong, Shashi Nathan. Once again, good morning, Shashi, and thank you so much for taking time off your busy schedule to join us this morning. Are you usually up so early?
No.
At least he's honest. An honest lawyer. There you go.
Now, Shashi, as a founding member of the Association of Criminal Lawyers, may I ask, what are the objectives of this association?
Mm.
Okay, so I should state I'm no longer a member.
Okay.
I've got other roles in the Law Society and the Academy now, but about 12 years ago, I was with a well-known criminal lawyer called Subhash.
Mm-hmm. Subhash.
We were the same firm together for about 6 years. And he and I actually came up with the idea of starting this association. At that time, the purpose of doing this was really to bring the criminal lawyers together. We had, of course, committees in the Law Society, we had groups in the Academy of Law, but we wanted a more informal group where we could discuss the developments in the law, developments in the practice, how we deal with the courts, with the prosecutors. So it started out as that. We wanted to have a grouping, a landing place for the criminal bar.
Mm.
And really what it was we already have it. We already have a strong fraternity at the bar, but this was kind of a codification of all the things we wanted to do.
I see.
So that was the purpose. It's still going on very strongly now. There are good people running the ACLS. I was there for a few years, but eventually I had to take on different roles with the Law Society and now with the Academy of Law. So I can't have too many of these extra bits going on because it takes up too much time. But they're very good. They've helped the criminal lawyers. But the bar, in general, has been very good. And one other thing is that actually the courts, in the last 10 years, since the present Chief Justice came on board, and even when he was the Attorney General, there's been an emphasis on developing criminal law and criminal lawyers in Singapore. So there's been much of effort to help the law develop, the practice develop. There's also a very close relationship now between the bar and the prosecutors. Traditionally, they always looked at each other with a little bit of distrust, a little bit of anxiety because you're up against each other in court.
Mm.
But, over the years, that has changed. I think efforts have been made to bring the different facets of criminal law in place, the judiciary, the criminal bar, the prosecutors. We're all actually different cogs on the same wheel. We just have a different role to play, but every role is important because for the administration of justice in Singapore, the prosecution has to present its cases clearly and fairly. The defense has also got to do its part. And of course, the court has to look at all this and make the right judgment. So you can't have one facet not working. All three parts must work together.
Mm. Mm. Now, Shashi, sometimes people see, lawyers in an unfavorable light. But people don't see the pro bono work that you guys do. Now, is this part of the CLAS or Criminal Legal Aid scheme? I'm talking about the pro bono work. And I know for a fact that you are a firm believer in this scheme. Please tell us why.
Well, okay, to give you a better sense, there are actually several schemes in Singapore which do pro bono work in Singapore. Mm. Most law firms, especially the larger firms, also dictate a minimum of pro bono hours to be done by their younger lawyers. I think that's an important thing to for lawyers to start early in their practices. Mm. We have CLASS, the Criminal Legal Aid Scheme, which is to help people who don't have that much money to afford a lawyer. And this is for cases primarily in the state courts. There are a few cases that go up to the High Court. And they could be ranged from offences like fighting, rioting, molest, theft, cheating. Mm. And it's an excellent program. There must be hundreds of lawyers on the pro bono scheme. It is run by good people at the Law Society. And it's worked for many years. And every year the lawyers will organize events to raise money for CLASS to make sure it's well funded. Right now the government is also funding it, so the program is working well. So you will never have a situation in Singapore where someone is not afforded legal representation just because he has no money. If you pass the means test and you really can't afford a lawyer and you have a case which deserves a defense, something will be provided for you.
Okay, that's always good to know.
There is one more program in the High Court for cases involving capital punishment. Mm. So for drugs and for murder cases, the High Court runs a system called LASCO. And this is the system where lawyers are appointed by the High Court to represent people who are facing the death penalty. Mm. And this is equally important because the vast majority of people who face the death penalty, and if you're caught for drugs, sometimes for murder, may not have the funds, because a private defense of a High Court death penalty case would cost you hundreds of thousands of dollars. Mm. So I think that works in tangent with the CLASS system to make sure that most people in Singapore get at least a decent form of representation.
Right. We are talking to Shashi Nathan, top criminal defense lawyer from Withers Carter Wong on The Big Show and TheBigShow.tv. Up next, Gloria Maria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine. Here's Conga on The Big Show, 1FM 91.3.
So Shashi, I mean, you as a lawyer, you know a lot about the legal system in Singapore, but what is a law that we lay people may not be aware of in Singapore? What are the more unusual laws that we may not be aware of in Singapore? Can you think of anything?
Walking around naked.
I know the questions people ask me all the time.
Walking around naked.
Okay, I know this is a morning show, but I think it's the first thing that comes to mind. Most people don't realize that prostitution is not an offense in Singapore.
Hmm. Oh, yes, that one, that I've heard.
The offense is actually soliciting. If you solicit for a customer, that is the offense.
So if you go up to the person, that's
what you mean. You bring in clients or whatever, but the act of prostitution per se is not an offense. Of course, if you're a pimp who lives off the earnings of the prostitution, that's a separate offense. Mm. But for the person who is indulging in prostitution, technically that's not an offense.
So that means getting paid for sex.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yeah.
So Sean, you're fine then.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're okay. Stop it. So in other words, Shashi, so if these prostitutes go through a pimp, right? And if they are caught, they will not go to jail. The pimp is going to go to jail. Is that it?
The pimp would go to jail for earning off the immoral earnings.
Yeah.
The prostitute depends. She could be in breach of other offences. Usually there's passport violations.
Oh, right. Okay.
The actual act of prostitution, unless she solicits, or he, could be he.
Yeah.
It's not an offence. Yeah.
Okay.
That's really interesting. How
many people realise that?
Yeah. You know, Shashi, one more thing. We are live on TheBigShow.tv right now. Yesterday when I posted the fact that you're going to be on the show this morning, quite a number of people were asking about, I think, a case that you're working on currently. I believe you are defending a guy named Ahmad Daniel.
That's right.
Yeah, how is that coming along?
It's an interesting case. I can't really go into the details of the case because it's live. It's going to go on sometime next year. So I can't go into the details. But it is an interesting case in the sense that it is going to be the first time in a very long time that there's going to be a prosecution for murder for a case where there is no body.
Oh, wow.
How do you do that then?
Oh.
Evidence?
So if you remember, way back in the 1960s, there was a famous case called Sunny Ang.
Yes.
A bit of a playboy race car driver who had many girlfriends.
Wasn't David Marshall the criminal defense lawyer back then?
He was, yeah. And Sunny Ang had brought his girlfriend out swimming, and the body was never found. All they found was a cut flipper. And of course, circumstantial evidence that he had bought insurance policies on her life the day before.
Right. Oh, wow.
So Sunny Ang was convicted and he hung. So it's not as if there's no precedent for this. I mean, the fact that they have no body doesn't preclude them from prosecuting this case.
Oh.
But without going into detail, I'm looking forward to this because I think it'll be interesting to see how the case develops and how we deal with the evidence that's going to be presented in court, because it's going to be something quite novel.
So the Sunny Ang case was the last time that this happened? No.
Well, it's the last big case that we all know about. I think there have been at least two other cases which I've read in my research where they proceeded to prosecute without a body, but there was...
Okay, hold on, Shashi. We're going for a traffic break. Hold on.
FM 91.3 traffic.
Not much has changed. The SLE towards the BKE, an accident at the BKE PIE exit. SLE towards the BKE, an accident at Woodlands Avenue 12 entrance as well. Stay within the speed limit. Have everyone buckled up. Be safe as you drive today.
Good morning, Singapore. It's The Big Show, and our special guest for today is top criminal defence lawyer from Withers Carter Wong, the one and only Shashi Nathan. Once again, good morning, Shashi.
Morning, guys.
And just now on Facebook, we were talking about, because I mentioned this, I think it's okay, because there's certain things that Shashi cannot talk about this case because it's ongoing. But it's really interesting because, as I was telling you guys, when I posted the fact that Shashi was going to be on the show today, quite a number of people were asking if Shashi could talk about this, and so you know, well, Shashi will talk about
what
we'll
he
talk
can
about
talk
it
about.
As much as he can. And this is the case of you defending a guy named Ahmad Daniel. Could you tell us a little bit more about this case?
Yeah, like the
Shashi
backstory.
Yeah.
Okay. As I said, you know, I don't want to speak too much about the facts of the case. All the details, because it is a live case, it will go on hopefully next year. But one of the interesting things about this case is that there is a prosecution for murder, and it is a prosecution where there is no body found. And it doesn't mean they can't secure a conviction, but there are difficulties in this case. And I think a lot of novel points will be thrown up for the first time. There have been cases in Singapore where people have been prosecuted even when no body has been found. And I think the case I mentioned briefly to you was in the 60s, where there was this famous case of Sunny Ang, where his girlfriend at that time had gone missing and they couldn't find the body, but they found a cut flipper and they found that he had taken out insurance policies against the girlfriend the day before. He was convicted, he was hung. The present case is still in its early days. We're still waiting for a lot of facts to be turned up. I think forensics and investigations are not complete yet. We're still waiting for information to come through, but I'm looking forward to it. I think it'll be a good case, it'll be interesting. And we'll see how that pans out probably early next year.
So basically, public knowledge is that your client is accused of murder of a girl, a 19-year-old girl, correct, whose body was never found, right?
Yes. Well, I mean, what you see is what you see in the press. I mean, she disappeared about 13, 14 years ago. And, you know, there's no evidence that I know of that she is dead. She might be alive, all I know. So, but I think that will all bear out when we start
in the courts.
Okay. Hey, Shashi, for the benefit of anyone who's thinking of going into law, I'm asking this because, I mean, Shashi is an amazing lawyer. He is an even more amazing person, and so that's the reason why I'm asking.
I'll buy you lunch after this.
All right, man. Sammy's.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what, in your opinion, Shashi, are the important qualities all lawyers must have?
Well, I wish I knew this when I started.
the gift of the gab.
Yeah, I think being able to speak comfortably, confidently is not always a good thing. Sometimes people can be overconfident. But to speak comfortably, you know, to be comfortable in your own voice, your own skin, and be comfortable how you deal with people, clients, courts, that's important. Sorry.
No, go ahead. I'm waiting for you to finish and then I have a question.
I think if you have that, you know, being able to be confident in your own voice, I think that's important. And of course, there are different areas of practice where the other skill sets come. As I told you earlier, I was told very unceremoniously when I first wanted to become a lawyer that I would never make a corporate lawyer. And probably that's a good thing for me in the long run.
Mm-hmm. You Absolutely. Know?
But I also think a strong sense of justice and fairness must be in your playbook, because you know in the practice of law you come across different situations where you're tested. You know, you've got your client's interests, you've got the court's interests, you've got the other side's opposing interests, mm-hmm. and you've got to act in a way that of course in your client's best interest, but never where you know you put yourself in a compromising position. Mm. One of the first things I tell all my colleagues who work with me is that you know your first and foremost duty is an officer of the court. You know, no matter how compelling your client's case is, or how much money he's going to pay you, or whatever he wants you to do, once you lose your standing within the court, you're never going to get it back. Mm. So your standing, your reputation, and you know your duty to the court must be paramount. If you got that, everything else should fall in place.
Okay, Shashi, because that question was asked, I've got this. You ask a lot of parents, what do you want your child to be? Mm. Doctor, lawyer, engineer. And at the same time, the parents will go, and there are so many lawyers in Singapore. Can you ever really have too many lawyers?
Well, I mean, actually, that's a good question. But the reality is there's so many areas of practice. You know, it's nowadays, I mean, in the old days, you'd have lawyers who were generalists, you know. Mm. You'd have a law firm and a lawyer would do a bit of everything. Do a bit of conveyancing, a bit of family law, criminal law, civil litigation. Mm. More and more nowadays, there are, of course, people who do a wide spread of work. But more and more lawyers, especially young lawyers, they want to specialize. Mm. You know, they may say, oh, look, I want to be an arbitrator. Let me do arbitration. Or I want to be a family lawyer. You know, let me go into that area. Mm. Or trusts. Or, you know, there's so many areas. I think there are more opportunities today for a lawyer to, of course, get a general breadth of practice. And then if you're interested, to really go and specialize. So, and I think the courts, the system encourages that. Mm. It wants people to get not just okay at something, but get really good at something.
Okay.
We'll continue this conversation with Shashi Nathan live on thebigshow.tv. But for the benefit of the people who are tuned into the radio right now, Shashi, thank you so much so much for joining us this morning. Before I let you go, on a scale of 1 to 10, how stressful is a regular day for you?
Well, I think the stress levels are maybe 7, 8 usually on an average day. But you know, I cheat a bit. You know, I give myself little rewards every day. Whether it's a nice meal I look forward to, or catch up with a few friends. I like people a lot, so I think people energize me. They give me energy. So if I make sure that any time of the day, you know, I've got a nice lunch here or dinner or a drink or even a chat, that is the equalizer. It reduces the difficulties. It makes life easier.
Mm, right. You're an amazing guy, Shashi.
I love that.
Amazing guy. Amazing guy. Amazing lawyer. We've been talking to Shashi Nathan from Withers Carter Wong right here on The Big Show and TheBigShow.tv. Up next, Jennifer Page. Here's Crush on 1FM 91.3. All right, we can continue right now on Facebook. I've just opened up,
Sean's
the question for you.
Yes,
Sean.
Oh, Shashi, you were saying about your stress levels and how you de-stress. I want to find out, like, what's your favorite go-to meal?
Wow, I think most people know the answer. But... Okay, also because I have a lot of friends who are chefs, I want to make sure I don't upset anyone.
say everything, all their names is I can say.
You can do shout outs if you want.
Yeah. Well, I think Glenn and Angel know that, you know, well, before this latest lockdown, at least once or twice a month, I'll be at Sami's at Dempsey.
Yeah,
if anyone wants to look for me, just come on a Sunday. We have different groups of friends there all the time, so that's. That's one of my go-to places. I'm in Dempsey a lot because that's convenient for me. I don't think I want to name any specific restaurants. But, you know, the food is part of it. The drinks are part of it. But really, it's the company. So, you know, sometimes I like to just catch up with a group of people. We can just chit-chat, you know. Catch up what's happened in the week. Sometimes I like even a one-on-one catch up like I've done with Glenn and Angel. You know, we just catch up what's happening in our lives for the last few months and all that. It's a small thing, but it helps a lot. I think the different people place different emphasis on it, but I think I've been very lucky, very fortunate. I'm surrounded by a lot of good people.
You are, yeah.
And I try to reciprocate the same way back as well.
Yeah. Wonderful. Okay, you guys got anything else for Shashi?
No, but once everything opens up, we're having lunch, that's for sure. we've been trying to do this for like a year.
But maybe not Sami's, okay?
No, not Sami's.
Somewhere
that obviously has vegan food. There you go.
Okay. She's vegan.
Yeah, he knows. We went, I think the last time we caught up was PS Cafe and I had my Impossible and he had a nice beef something.
Yeah. But we got to go to a place where she can eat vegan and the rest of us can eat.
Of course, yes. Well, I still want to go to that place on Kyong Siak, the one you were always saying, the Sri Lankan one.
No. Kyong Siak is Tevar.
That one.
I'll do a plug for him. Mm. Excellent food, guys. You guys try it at least once.
Yes, we'll go there.
All right, let's do it, man. Let's do it.
All right, Shashi.
Shashi, take care of yourself.
Thanks, guys. Good to see all of you.
Great talking to you as well. Thank you so much. I know on behalf of all the fans, listeners who are tuned in, they're very grateful that you've come on the show this morning. They finally get to see you and hear you talk about this wonderful profession of yours.
Yeah,
we only forgot to talk about one thing, Glenn.
What
was that?
Next year, menu. We will win.
Don't worry. I think we'll do okay.
We'll do it. We are improving.
Yeah. Yeah, we got to shut the Liverpool fans up. They're a bit too noisy.
You know, I'm a Liverpool fan, Shashi, and if we don't win it, I would want United to win it because we've had enough of City, man.
To be fair, I think Liverpool, you've had a wonderful 2 years, and all credit, but I think it's our turn now, man.
I think so. It's about time. Definitely, it's about time. Okay, Shashi, we'll catch up soon.
Okay, guys.
All right, take care.
Bye. Take care.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Jang Jang.
Jang Jang Johan.
Jang Jang Johan in the house.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning. Shashi, yeah, okay.
Okay, so this morning, you're going to be doing a few, rock songs, I hear.
Oh, wow. I don't know.
I love the way you say,
you
I hear.
From where?
He is like totally surprised.
Wasn't you? I thought
who are you hearing from?
A little bird.
A little bird.
A little bird, okay.
Those are the voices in your head.
You prepare, right? You prepare a couple of songs, right?
Sort of.
I love how hard you work for this, man.
I love Johan. You know, like he has no idea what he's going to do.
No. He's like, what do you guys feel like?
Surprise.
I think, you know, from now on, let's not ask Johan. Let's just let him entertain us.
You're the one that was trying.
You know how I was trying to make people look like, you know, they're, you know, I set people up.
A good entertainer is he can just come on, switch the camera on, and just do his thing.
Okay.
Just
do it, well. Johan. Do
all right, bro.
All right, here you go.
Go ahead.
You know you're everything to me that I could never see.
the two of us apart. And you know I give myself to you.
Woo!
And no matter what you do, I promise you my heart.
Give me your light to that beat.
I feel my world around you, and I want you to know I need you like I never needed anyone before.
Honey is watching us from the next room. Your light up.
I live my life for you. I wanna be by your side and everything that you do. And if there's only one thing you can't believe it's true, I live my life for you.
Yeah, this one song.
Turn it all off.
I was afraid I have to turn off all the lights, right? I wouldn't be able to see the switch after that. Now I wouldn't know how to switch it on.
You should know the studio well enough to be able to walk around with it with your eyes closed. One more? There you go.
Holy
wow. This is nice. I like this. There you go.
Okay, another song that will require me to...
Yeah, since our flashlights are out, I'll do a set one.
Wow. Any requests?
A BTS song?
Oh!
Yeah, we've got requests for Butter, by the way.
Anya Seyo!
Yeah, Butter.
Really?
Take him a week to practice first. Hey, wait, we flashlight the battery,
yeah? Yeah, boy.
Yeah, hurry up.
The pressure.
Wow.
Come on, Johan.
People with epilepsy don't watch this.
Let's do... You know what? Hong Yi Kang came in the other day, right?
Mm-hmm.
He said one of his favorite songs is from the Foo Fighters.
Yes, Everlong.
Let's do that one.
That's his alarm.
Yeah.
And my alarm as well.
Minister Hong Yi Kang, the song is for you.
Hey. Hang on, let me detune. Yeah?
Detune.
All right, here we go.
Hello, I'm waiting here for you. Ever long. Tonight, I throw myself into out of your bed, out of your head.
Sean needs a haircut.
I hope you wash your hair, Sean.
Hey!
Everything will be flying all over the place.
Oh my. Come down and waste away with me. Down with me. Slow how you wanted it to.
You know what's really good here? I finally got a really good image of the missing link.
I've got
a missing link in the evolution of man.
Oh, sorry, did you say
Hafiz? And I wonder, when I sing along with you, if everything could ever feel this way forever, if anything could ever be this good again.
What's wrong with Sean?
The only thing I'll ever ask of you.
He's on drugs.
Gotta promise not to
stop
and I say when
she
sang.
Minister Ong is also dancing.
You know what FD needs? FD needs this.
Hantu.
Yay, yeah, well done.
Yay.
Thank you.
Turn on the lights.
So we can stop Sean.
Oh my goodness.
When the lights go out.
Yeah.
That's nice.
Wow, that was weird.
Ooh,
lights
very
are
good,
back. Lights
very
are back.
Good.
You know, I just adopted a cat recently.
Oh,
wow.
What's
his name? Really distracting. Mochi.
Mochi.
His name is Mochi.
Oh, his name. Yeah, sorry. Okay.
What kind of cat is it?
A Siamese.
Oh, nice.
Oh, Siamese, nice.
Yep.
Siamese means
what?
Got
no, he didn't say Siamese twins.
Twins.
Not twins.
Cat,
it's a Siamese cat.
Yeah, okay. He's 8 months old.
Aww.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, he's very active now. I don't know why.
Let's see, catch him and show him to us.
What do you mean, catch him?
Yeah, you gotta catch him. We gotta run after him and catch him.
How far away?
You gotta walk your cat, no, sometimes.
I know, I'm going to try that, man.
FD's just used to rabbits these days, that's why.
No, I'm also used to cats. I'm also used to cats because my daughter adopted a cat recently.
So, oh, yeah. But that's a big cat, you see. Your daughter's cat is as big as a tiger. His daughter's cat is a Maine Coon.
No, he's part Maine Coon, and he's still a kitten, so.
Oh, okay.
He's still very
simple. Okay, hang on. I want to do a shout out to Jacqueline. She sends in a WhatsApp. She goes, I'm out today from my 21-day quarantine, the longest ever quarantine, and she knows it's not dedication time, but she'd like to do a shout out to her family who have supported her and all frontline staff from the airport to the hotel that she was staying at, Furama Riverfront, and our radio station for keeping her company 24/7. Welcome back to the real world, Jacqueline. Well done with the 21 days.
You know, this has given me an idea.
Tell me.
I think when we come back from our leave, let's do a dedication hour as well.
Yeah. Oh, nice.
So anyone who has words of encouragement during this time, right, can send us a voice message and we will play your voice message.
What do you mean, like, oh, hi, I'm the Flying Dutchman and I would like to tell so-and-so, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah, to stay strong, keep calm during this period or whatever.
Great. And you know, interesting...
Ta-da! Here you go.
Hey! Look at him. Mochi.
So pretty.
So handsome.
Very nice. Well, yeah, pretty boy. That's all right. That's true. What? Interestingly enough, when you do come back from your leave, by the way, you're not on next week, Johan. So you can take a break. It'll be the 14th of June, which means after that whole, hopefully, phase 2 heightened period. It'll be exactly
on
that day.
Let's go for a nice lunch.
Yes, let's. Hopefully
They'll allow 5 people.
5 people together. Yeah, hopefully then. Yeah, and then we can start our dedication hour.
Okay,
yeah, good. That's perfect for them. Yeah. Perfect.
But thank you, Jacqueline, for inspiring us.
There you go. There you go. Thank you, Jacqueline, and welcome back to the real world.
Okay, and thank you very much, Johan, for joining us today.
No worries.
And congratulations, Mochi.
We look forward to seeing you on the 16th. Okay.
16th. Oh yeah, of course. Yeah.
Oh yes, when you come back to the big show. We'll have Abba Saad that day. Abbasad will be on.
Wow.
Yeah. So.
Is he here in Singapore?
He's here in Singapore, he is.
Right.
He's now coaching in Singapore.
I see.
Taking up a new position, so we'll find out a little bit more about that. Morning, Abbas!
And we'll find out what his favorite song is. Maybe you can play it. We'll give you 2 weeks' notice.
Cool.
Okay, take care, Johan. Thank you so much.
Take care, mate.
See ya.
Bye.
All right, everyone. Hope you enjoyed the session today with our top criminal defense lawyer, Shashi Nathan from Withers Qatar Wong. Please share the video. Bye-bye.